So, hello everyone. Sorry for delay. And fortunately, we had such a good talk about optimization in text search and handling of a huge text arrays. But anyhow, I'm going to present my lightning talk about big step to functional programming. And I want just to pay your extra attention that this talk is for beginner level. So if you are more or less experienced in the functional programming, that might be boring for you. But since you are already here, so let's just share this time with you. So my name is Alex Walinsky, and I'm a senior Scala developer at VidIQ. What is actually VidIQ? It's a small company which works to make YouTubers' life easier by improving statistics and analytics for bloggers and any YouTube channels. And we do their Scala a lot of big data, and so forth. So. Also, I'm writing some articles to my blog, so mostly it's Scala related and infrastructure related, such as Kubernetes or some tricks with functional programming or reactive programming with Akka and so on. Also, you can find me in social networks such as Twitter, LinkedIn, Facebook, or GitHub. So, let's start from my favorite slide. Actually, I truly believe that there is somewhere far, far, far away from here a smart form of life who writes code without any mistakes, bugs, and so on. And I believe that that's possible due to some mysterious techniques. And probably we are just in the beginning of that road, and functional programming looks pretty promising in this huge way. And that's why I think that if we will try to apply this knowledge, which I'm going to share with you during this presentation, to our real life problems, we may try to make a small step to that ideal code where we will have a better understanding of what this code does, and how to maintain it, how to reason about it, and so on. Just to be more closer to domain area, I decided to create some tiny example for this presentation, and its topic pretty trivial. So I'm going to consider two services. So the first one is the user service, and it has two methods. The first one is the add user, the second one is the get user. And the second one, service, is offer service. And it has just three methods, add offer, get offer, and delete offer. So based on this example, I will just demonstrate you several code samples which we regularly use. If, of course, we have a Java background, for example, in a regular formal way of declaring some business logic. And also, I will show you a functional alternative, which I will name a little bit further. So just to input some basic context, so here is a set of basic types which we are going to use. So as you see, we have a user ID, which is just a simple alias to a regular Scala string. Then we have a name, then we have offer ID, then we have a message, and then we compose from this customly defined types some domain models such as user and offer. And finally, we declare two dummy storages for users and offers appropriately. By storages, I mean just a regular mutable Scala maps. So, by the way, who does Scala in their past lives? So just two of audience, okay. So no problem. I will make you a small demo of how any Scala Java developer think about the problem of creating some data access layer to user entity and then to the offer entity as well. So basically, it's pretty common to create firstly some sort of interface. In Scala, we use trait. in order to represent interface for data access layer. And here we just describe a signature of methods which we are going to apply to this data model. So such as add user, we are going to accept some user add parameter to this function, and we are going to return nothing. And if we are going to describe get user, we just want to send a user ID to this function, and hopefully we will receive a user in case if this ID actually exists, and otherwise we will receive none. And as you see, also we are going to declare an implementation of this interface. By implementation, I mean a separate class. There we are going to pass some real implementation of a user storage, and as you see, we just add some real implementation to each of these methods. So in the first case, we are going to get from the map by its key some user, and sorry, to add user, we are going to put this key and associate a appropriate user entity with it. And in case we are, if we want to get a user, we just want to get an entity from the map by its ID. And as I told previously, if it exists, we return it in an option wrapper, so some, or otherwise we return none. And the same we should do with offer entity as well. So the same code for offer DAO interface, and then we implement it similarly as to the previous entity. So we are just operating with some mutable map entities inside of it. And finally, we want to see how we can compose all of this stuff into the real program. So by real program, I just want to consider a pretty simple case where firstly we want to add a user by using a user DAO, and then we want to get this user, and just for demonstration purposes, I want to print this user. So as you see, firstly, I declare an empty map, which represents a user database. Then I create a new user DAO implementation bypassing the previously initiated user database. And finally, I execute these two simple actions, so which I actually declared in the previous entities, I mean DAO layer. So firstly, I add particular user with ID UID 01 and with the name Alex, and then I just get this user and assign it to appropriate value, and then I print it. So in this case, the output will be some user with these attributes which I passed further. And if we are pretending to do something more functional, we are going to refer to a for comprehension style, and that's how it looks like. And unfortunately, it won't work just because the first one method from this for comprehension expression, it returns unit, and unit doesn't imply a definition of flat map on it. So that's why such formulation isn't valid for a standard way of implementation. So we should be declarative. Line by line, we are just putting logic which we are going to execute further. And next, I'm going to consider another one solution. And before that, I just want to make some alert to all of you, because I will refer to some entities declared in a cats library. And by the way, who knows what is the cats library here? All right. By the way, if you know, maybe you know what these two functions are about, I mean, what data type they are related to. Just one word. It's a monad. So monad defines just two operations. So the first one is the point, and that's nothing else like a wrapping some value, sorry, not value, but some wrapper around a value. And the second one function is about retrieving a value from a wrapper and then applying a new function and returning a new value around the same wrapper. So point and flat map. And this data structure, it helps us to take a control under execution flow of some operations. So it helps us to build a strong sequence of actions which should be executed one by one. So this is really important for further understanding of next code snippets. So I told previously about another solution, another functional solution, and let's try to build it from scratch. We are considering the same problem. So the problem of building a way to access a data source and to make some operations on top of it. And here you see that I defined a sealed trait which has a name user operations and it accepts some type A. And then I create another two case classes which just literally declare what actions they intend to do. And they extend these user operations and I pass to each of these operations a returning type of add operation and get operation appropriately. So this is just a set of operations which we can do under the user repository. And it looks pretty simple. Then I'm doing a pretty mysterious thing because I import some entity from a cats library and it has a name free. I believe that it's not obvious for all of you what does it mean right now, but to the end of this presentation, you will understand what it does actually and how it could be referenced to the monad principle, which we discussed on the previous slide. And by now, I just want to emphasize that let's think about this user storage type, like about some intermediate entity which will be needed by our program to perform some real actions under these repositories. I mean, in this case, we are talking about user repository. And then we are defining two methods which previously was placed into the DAO entity. And here we use absolutely the same signature, so we are going to use the same names, I mean add and get, and then we pass the same parameters to this function as in that repository. But the returning types are different, so we are returning this mysterious type user storage, and we put there exactly those types, I mean unit and option user, which correspond to each of these operations. And finally, we implement both of these methods by using liftf function from the cat library, which helps us to create so-called smart constructors. And this principle actually just allows us to think about these functions as functions which will operate just with these predefined values from the first code snippet. And finally, the most important thing here, it's a compiler. So here we import some extra things from the cats library, such as ID and wavy arrow. So ID is nothing else like a simple redundant wrapper, and it hasn't any actually functional load on it. It just helps us to operate with value inside of it, so nothing complex. And about the wavy arrow, it's something what think about like about the map function. So when we're talking about map function, we are going to convert value of type A to value of type B, and a wave arrow, it goes a little bit further and it transforms type, for example, option A into the type option B. So it adds some extra level of wrappers around these values. And essentially, the compiler is translating user operations into this entity ID. And this is required for our implementation just because we are going to express our realization of operations which relates to user through these functions which we defined in the previous code snippet. I mean add, get, and so on. And further in this compiler, we just interpret all of these returning types into the real operations which we are going to do. Where is the arrow? All right, so just take your attention into the user storage operation where we associate with the user ID some particular user, and the same for the get, where we want to get from the user storage some user by referring to it ID. And finally, oh, something went wrong. Actually, this is the same code snippet as on the previous slide, so take attention on the second code snippet. Here we are declaring what we are going to do. So this is an alternative to the first one solution, which was a regular one where I used repositories. So as you see here, we use the same steps. So firstly, we want to add a user to our database, and then we want to get it. And finally, I yield println method by passing user, which we added recently in the previous step, to our database, and it will return some user with those attributes. But don't hurry up, because exactly in this place, the program won't be executed yet, because here we just declare what should be done. And just after, we will run it by using on top of computation value a fold map bypassing a compiler, which we written, by the way, the first one snippet is shown here just for demonstration. So you now can recognize why it happens so. So we declare a set of computation, then we fold all of them by applying each of these elements from this computation to the compiler, which we declared as well. So that's how this approach looks like. I mean, functional approach. And its name is the free monad. Why actually free and why actually monad? So as you remember from my explanation of what monad is, it's about sequencing of operations. And why free? That's because we are free to decide how we want to interpret these commands. So in some sense, we want to test our code. And that means that we can define another one compiler, which will operate, for example, not with a real database or not asynchronously with our data storage or third-party service, but just in a regular way, I mean synchronously, and without referring to a real data source, we can just use, for example, in-memory database or just a simple mutable map, for example. So that's the main concept of a free monad. And just to sum up what we did, so we firstly defined ADT. ADT stands for algebraic data type. It's when we are declaring a set of our operations by using the same interface. In our case, that was a user ops. Then we create a free monad for this ADT. After that, we are writing a compiler. So doesn't matter, is it for testing purposes or for production purposes. And finally, we compose a declaration of these functions which were declared in a compiler. And finally, in that place where we need to execute that program, we just run it by folding it through the compiler. So this is the main concept which we should adhere in order to transform our regular procedural code to the functional representation by using free monads. But what about the fact of synchronous operations which I provided in the first example. Just take a quick look on how this new code snippet looks like. So here I return, instead of regular unit and pure optional user, some asynchronous computation instead. I mean future unit and future option user. So that actually adds some more realistic properties to the code, because in any production ready code, I'm sure that you are using exactly asynchronous computations, because, well, actually in all of the conference talks and in all of the books you will write that it's better to use all of the power which you have on your computational stations rather than waiting for all of the results in a synchronous way. So that's how we will compose more complex computation. This time I just decided to add, in addition to users, repositories, offers repositories, since I declared that in the first slides. And here you see that I also compose some computations in a for comprehension. So firstly I add user, then I just want to add some offer to exactly this user which was added. Then I want to get an offer which was added in the previous step. Then I want to delete this offer. And finally, I want to ensure that the offer which was deleted on the previous step is really absent in our data store. And finally, in the Yield code snippet, you can see that I just want to print all of this result. I mean, firstly, that to ensure that the offer was added, and finally, to check that it was deleted successfully. And of course, it's not something what should be copy-pasted to a production version of code, because as you see, I just put here some effects without any wrappers. I mean, I/O such as a println, but it's made here just for demonstration purposes. And finally, I'm waiting for a result for 1 second, and the output will be exactly as shown in the commands. So we can ensure that the user, so that the offer was added to the right user, and finally that it was deleted as expected. So how to implement the same sort of logic by referring to the concept which I presented on the previous slides with the name free monad. So we are starting from the same steps. We are going to declare an ADT, I mean algebraic data type. So nothing is changed comparing to the previous slides with the free monad example. So here I add the same demonstration of smart constructors for the user free monad. And finally, I create a compiler for it, and just pay your extra attention. There is just one difference comparing to the previous free monad example with the user. Instead of ID, which was a simple wrapper, I put here a future. That's another wrapper which we can use for example, just for production purposes, because sometimes it doesn't make any sense to use a synchronous code in a production. So this means that this is exactly what I talked previously, that depending on the situation where you're going to use these free monads, you can just select the right implementation of the compiler, which will fit your need exactly in that place where you want to use it. And in the apply function, you can see that in case, for example, add user, I just wrap this operation on mutable map into the future. So it will be calculated somewhere in the future. And finally, I run this program exactly as in the first example of free monad. By folding the set of expressions through the compiler which we defined. And what about combination I mean combination of two repositories, because I told you that we can combine two repositories, I mean user and offers, and I showed you how it can be done in a Java style, Java-like style, it would be more correctly to say. So what if we have two domain areas or two entities which need to be served through the free monad? So in this case, we are defining two entities as well, but then we want to gather them by applying either key data structure just to be sure that we are able to make some combination of the actions on top of these two separate free monads. And then we are starting doing pretty the same steps as before, but take your extra attention on some modifications, such as inject key instead of smart wave arrow. So because here we need to ensure that we are lifting exactly same ADT element which corresponds to the right operation, because in the user operations we want to inject key user ops, and in the block where we declare a class with the offer operations, we want to make smart constructors for offer operations. So this is the main point. And finally, we are writing interpreters separately for user operations and for the offers operations. And here we are using exactly the same approach as in the previous, more simple example for user operations free monad. And finally, we are just making sure that our main interpreter, which will work on top of these two free monads, I mean user one and offer one, we just collect them in the value main interpreter in the last line of this code snippet. And finally, we are going to compose a main program which will be executed in a separate function, which I named a program. And I pass there implicitly a set of operations which we are going to use. So in this case, user operations and offer operations. And I'm going to just use a straightforward lines of code which express our logic. So firstly, we add user, then we add offer to this user, and the same steps in the like as in the previous example. So we are going to see that the offer was added successfully, then we are deleting that offer, and finally we are checking that the offer was deleted successfully, and by ensuring that we see that it returns none. And once again, this code snippet doesn't do anything just because this is a declaration. And in order to run it, we need to fault all of these operations through the main compiler which we declared previously. So this is the main concept how you can make a huge change into your daily code which you are writing in a regular way, I mean imperative way, by introducing a method which has a name free monad. So this approach helps you in multiple ways, such as you are free to create multiple implementation for testing purposes and for production purposes, for example. You are getting for free a pretty nice DSL, so you are able then to create a well-structured code just by writing these four comprehension line-by-line expressions, and to think about some logic as about the set of sequence operations. And finally, it's a good chance to start doing some functional programming, because as you see, this is a good trend which continues to grow up since every next year. We see more and more talks and benefits which speakers trying to highlight regarding the functional programming. So big thanks for listening this lightning talk, and I hope that you will be interested to see all of these code snippets which are live now on my repository in the Scala UA 2019 repository. So feel free to play with it and, for example, to apply that templates for your live solution, for example. So big thanks.
Сейчас будет розыгрыш возле стенда Grid Dynamics, так что все, кто участвует, пожалуйста, подойдите туда.
Будет розыгрыш. Идем.